accept these minutes?
Motion.
Do we have a second?
Second.
So no suggested changes?
I have some changes.
Oh, okay, go for it.
Page two under Chris Mason, that sentence after 25,000 board feet, that doesn't quite make sense. I think Crisfield Solar isn't going to boom, but will progress, and he does not foresee a problem. And then next sentence, there are ways to plant, delete the ing. Instead of, two more lines down, instead of down in a few parking lots for solar, instead of reasons, I'd replace that with feasibility.
Say that one again, where is that?
The next sentence.
Chris spoke about the feasibility studies that are being done in a few parking lots for solar reasons, deleted reasons, put back feasibility or something like that. And then next, a section down, fall planting, first sentence towards the end, ratio was good, and I think that's consensus.
Oh, yeah, consensus, not census.
And just under any other business, next page at the bottom, the Downtown North Hampton Association, that partner, is at the ED.
And I see, I'm looking on your notes here. I think what you may have done, Terry, is take the agenda and work and create minutes based on the agenda. And so I would eliminate on page three the bullet that says looking to spring. You see that one, top of the page?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so vote to accept the minutes as amended by Todd. Okay, minutes have been accepted as amended. No public comment because there's no public today. And so we'll go on to the chair report. Okay, so I have three items. One is the urban tree planting workshop. Rob, are you going to be able to go? I don't think I'm going to be able to go.
Andrew will be there, and I would go then. Also.
Andrew Smith, great.
Yes.
Okay, terrific. Okay, so that's terrific. Can you maybe write some notes and prepare to summarize?
I'm the worst, but I'll do my best.
Okay, thank you.
And Andrew may also take this.
Okay, great. Well, I'll just have you responsible for that task.
Yeah. Yeah.
You can delegate it to Andrew since he's not here.
Right. I think they're particularly addressing future of what we might do on downtown areas.
Yeah, I know. Rich, do you know if Doug is going to make it to that?
Doug said he was planning on going. I talked to him this morning.
Great.
Good.
That's really
so
good.
So he's going to go, which is good. I'm not going to be able to go because we have some issues that have to deal with, like flood control walls. I think we're going to make an attempt to erect a flood control wall on West Street for practice. We have to do one a year. Okay. Take photos of it and send it to the Army Corps of Engineers. It's not a project, but we may do it, we may not do it. Depends on the weather.
All right.
So.
Okay. Well, it's good to know that Doug's going to be there.
He is going to be there.
Okay, good.
They may let you have their PowerPoint, like if you ask them. You know what I mean?
They might have one.
Yeah.
They may be doing a PowerPoint. Sometimes they're willing to email it to you or whatever. That may save you taking notes. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Great idea.
Okay. As you all saw, I sent a letter of thank you to the Gazette. It did have the mayor's blessing. So that's done. And then I had a couple of very interesting interviews this week. One I'll address later down under research regarding Friends of Northampton Trails and Greenway. And this one, I'm just going to give a really basic, because I sent you all the notes, but since we are not going to have the, I don't know if you all saw, did you send it just to me, the word that the tree crew is not going to be able to be here?
No, I just sent it to everyone.
You sent it to everyone, okay, so that means that we have 25 minutes of time that we could, you know, elaborate more deeply on another subject. So if we want to go more deeply into the bare root conversation, I'm happy to, just to say that, you know, as I think I mentioned a long time ago, this time last year, I visited two really nationally recognized tree programs. One, the Pennsylvania Horticultural Society, and the other was Casey Trees, and interviewed their directors or program officers at like for 2 or 3 hours each. And that's when I was first turned on to the bare root method. And then I thought of it again because I know we're marching forward with this plan to create a tree nursery, and I just thought, you know, before we go, you know, head into it, we would just zoom out for another second and look to see if it is the most efficient, economical, best use of our time and resources. Because it is a commitment, and I have a very personal perspective of what it's like to launch an on-the-ground program through Grow Food Northampton, specifically through the community garden. So I really have an appreciation for the hundreds of man hours that go into maintaining a site. It's not a small thing. So before we, you know, before we go so down the road that it's going to be hard to turn back, I really just, and I'm not saying that either are mutually exclusive, but I spent, you know, some time being pretty convinced that the bare root tree option is a really good one. So just to say that you've got my notes, and if we want to do something like visit the nursery, although it sounds from them like there's nothing to go see. You know, the trees are just in the ground like normal trees. It's just the way they're taken out of the ground. Mm-hmm. It's different. Or if we want to bring somebody in who has a lot of experience running volunteer programs with the bare root method, I can do that because a friend of mine used to work for the Pennsylvania Horticultural Society as their volunteer coordinator for tree tenders. She just happened to have moved to Western Massachusetts. So I can invite her in to talk about it. It's a really different model of volunteer coordination, you know, in terms of like a one day, just crazy big planning day. So we can do that too. So that's really my chair report. It's just those two things, and then later on the friends, conversation with the friends of the Northampton Green Trails and Green Lines.
I think the bare root, of course, does present a problem of getting everyone out on one day, or actually a couple of days, eventually. Do it all at one time. I think when we're looking at the bare root, which I was great to have good videos and whatnot from Pennsylvania and those collected, we should probably be comparing bare root to possibly trees grown in grow bags. A tree in a grow bag is essentially they take a bare root, they leave it in the ground for a year or two, and then it's a very lightweight thing that moves around, and the prices aren't that different. The big difference is selection.
Okay, so it sounds like you want to have a conversation about it. How about we just save this until we get past the tree warden report?
Well, actually, I don't know that we need to have it. I just wanted to put that out there that when we're thinking, just as we go about thinking about it, that we should be thinking about
absolutely.
I'd like to have a conversation.
Okay. Yeah, so let's have a conversation. Okay.
Let's have a conversation. How about we do it in the period of 25 minutes when we would have had the tree crew here. Okay? All right. Turn it over to you.
Thank you. I don't have a lot to report. Still working on a revolving account for the tree monies that we received from the two residences. I just had a conversation with Susan Wright while setting up another revolving account again, and we're still waiting for DOR to give us the go-ahead to actually use the revolving account. So we're actually going to put the monies, deposit them in miscellaneous receipts because we have to cash the checks. And then what's going to happen is that we'll do a financial transfer into the new account once it's been approved by the City Council. After DOR gives us the go-ahead, the City Council has to approve this account that we can use if it's going to be a revolving account or what type of account it's going to be, and then we can just transfer the monies over. So the monies will not get lost, but they have the money, the cash, the checks have to be cashed. So I've been working with Rob, kind of behind the scenes, which I think we're probably going to maybe talk about at some point, maybe not, about the planting the rest of the trees that we have. Rob and I have a meeting tomorrow at 8:00 in the morning. We did go to Amherst Nursery yesterday, and we picked up 20 trees from Amherst Nursery. So we have about 30 trees or so to still plant, which Rob has staked out. 29 locations that have all been dig safe and all ready to go. So what we're going to do is we're going to probably use a combination of forces, public or private folks, and then DPW folks after, possibly starting next week, because I have two and a half days that we can actually get some plantings done next week, and then the following week we should be done. So we're going to coordinate all this. We'll have over 100 trees planted.
Given that we had some challenges, you know, in our first round, early fall, of matching the right tree with the right site, have you all given that more consideration this time?
It's actually been difficult because, just particularly aware that the European hornbeam that we got from other than the ones that are coming now were fairly narrow, you know, they were not spreading. And so I went ahead and checked with Amherst Nursery to make sure that the ones that we're getting now, the European hornbeams, would be fully spreading. And there was a lot of confusion, so that's why I'm having to meet with Rich, is that it sounded like they were going to be fully spreading. And then I had another conversation with Amherst Nursery where it turned out they're not. So, you know, they're not exactly probably pyramidal, but they're not fully spreading. So we're struggling with that. We're going to have to relocate some of the trees and, you know, move them around and figure it out. And we left some of them in Amherst. Mm-hmm. So we had planned to plant 6 of them, European hornbeams. I think we're going to plant 3. There are places where I think they're appropriate, but yeah, we're definitely dealing with it.
Yeah, I mean, from my perspective, this is the part that takes maybe, it requires the most time and the most care, because once a tree's in the ground, unless we're prepared to move it, which, you know, in some cases I do think from South Street we need to move some trees, yeah, but that's not the ideal. So yeah. I would just like to express, and I know I've done this before, that as much time be taken as needed to site the right tree for
I put a lot of time in, and after I was done, though I didn't know about the European hornbeam problem, when I relied on at least three experts to come by, and so in other words, I drove around with Jay, and I've gotten Rich's input, and I have Andrew Smith. But, you know, it's imperfect in any case.
Is it because it was particular cultivars?
Yeah, exactly. That cultivar is hard to pin down. They're not telling me.
A lot of nurseries don't give you all that information.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Don't give you the whole story when you go buy the trees.
Right.
So most people don't really know the difference. Mm-hmm. So.
And so even now that we have more of a story, we're still not exactly sure.
So I'm wondering, learning from this, right, does this mean we just need to pad the time we think it's going to take to site the right tree with the right spot?
Oh yeah.
More, we need to give ourselves more time.
The way that it should be done is that we have the map now, and in the winter the map should start being propagated with, as Rich is doing, you know, where he puts in an approved tree and then he put down the species, and then it can be thought about, and then if there's a problem, then something can be done about it. But the way it has been catch up, because it takes such a great amount of time to go out and, mm-hmm, I think 4 or 6 of these trees, at least 5, are setback plantings. Just to get someone to agree to a setback planting is a long period of time. You've got to go talk to them, you got to go back and talk to them. So I've been doing that. So a lot of time's gone into it. Mm-hmm. Gone into it. And some of it's kind of really understanding what the power line people will do to the tree exactly. Like, for instance, the European hornbeam that I thought we would have would be a fairly large spreading tree. But it could still go under the taller power lines, or at least offset from them, because there are trees that's particularly well-suited for some pruning. Like, in other words, it doesn't have a central leader. At the end, it's just kind of this big bush. And, you know, not everyone would necessarily agree, but there were some places where it was being used in that way. And in fact, I think one went under the power line on Bates Street. Is that right?
I don't want to divert too much from Rich's tree ward report, but I do, I guess my request is not necessarily to get in the weeds about this, but more for you guys just to be thinking systems-wide, like what systems you need to create so that the time and attention to citing trees is appropriate. And, you know, and so that we do this right the first time instead of having to double our efforts.
I think we all know it's really bad to do it close to the time of planting.
Yeah, right.
But the problem is that now we are close to the time of planting, no matter. It's really better to get some of these in the ground than to leave them for the winter. Just because they're not all going to be necessarily in great shape after the winter where they are. It'd be better if we could do more.
Do we not have a backup plan for healing them in somewhere?
We do.
Okay. We can. If we don't have a plan, that they can stay at the DPW or fine.
Okay.
They should be fine.
But I think it's still good to put them in. And,
well, if they're in the right spot.
Yeah. And I also really like people to have the experience dealing, hopefully, people in this room planting some of the grow back ones. Because part of the whole thing we've been doing is an experiment. What's it like to have B&B, what's it like to have potted, what's it like to have, you know, I mean, there's definitely a learning issue here. But not only will we put them in the ground, but then we'll wait and see how they work.
Okay. When you populate, like in the best case scenario, let's say we don't have this pile of trees that, oh my God, we have to get in the ground. Mm-hmm. When you populate the map, with, okay, here's a site, is there a way to like code the sites or something, you know what I mean?
Yeah, the problem with Google Map, it's very basic.
Yep.
So when we migrate everything to GIS, we can really play around with it to the point where you can actually see utility wires, because that's a helpful tool that avoids me from having to go out in the field necessarily every time to look at a site location. So you can do a lot of different things with GIS. So there, we kind of, if you think about the way we did this, we kind of did this backwards.
Oh, totally.
We didn't have any sites set up per se.
Yeah.
We bought all the trees because we were pressed to expend funds. And so we just kind of put the cart before the horse, but we seemed to manage to shake off that dust and get it all done. And it is a huge scramble to do that many plantings in that short period of time. So I think we'll, not only a conversation about planting locations and the proper trees that go in this location, we need to have a really overall discussion, maybe a little subgroup that we can talk about how we're gonna go about doing this next year.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, do we change the format a little bit? You know, do we spread it out over the whole year? You know, just kind of have a free conversation
where we can just kind of
throw these ideas out there and try to throw what's gonna work. We take the things that worked really well this year and just incorporate them into next year's plan. So, and then you can talk to other communities and figure out what they've been doing, and if it works for them,
we'll work with them. Yeah. I was worried I was going to take it back.
So, yes, Jen, the long and the short of it, yes, you can do that. GIS is amazing. You can do anything with GIS. So,
there potentially could be like numbered sites, okay,
yeah.
And then you could click on, or whatever, access site number one, and it could be sandy soil, full sun, power lines.
Right.
We could have several
5 foot
codes.
Tree belts.
Yes, different codes that you could, and then you could, someone could even, we could have a subcommittee that could look at, you know, you could certainly do that, but if you're jammed for time, we could have a subcommittee that would look at those specs and have a tree list and say these would be the 5 species that would make it there.
And I think what would really be beneficial would be if we get the monies approved from DCR, because that's gonna be part of the inventory. So we would have a jump of potentially 1,000 sites once we do the RFP.
That's part of the,
yeah, that's
not just existing, but open.
Identification of 1,000 identification of 1,000 locations for tree planting, you know, site conditions.
Oh, wow.
Utilities, you know, the full gamut of what's there, so we actually know. So that would really be beneficial, because then all that information is just going to get dumped into the city's GIS system at DPW, and then you have it all. So it really saves us the trouble of, you know, family trees we plant a year's time. Say we do 100, for example, 100 a year, you know, we have 10 years worth of information. I expect we're going to do more than that, though.
Part of your tree ward report, I gave here a note to myself to ask you about the Tree City USA status.
That is just a matter of me actually finishing the paperwork.
Okay, and that's, you're on that.
That'll be done before the deadline.
Okay, great.
So I just want to say, I have gone out there for hours, it's very hard to cite a tree. I'm taking into consideration matters that are not evident sometimes when standing there. So if there's a potential setback that I think is preferable, and even though there's a tree belt, often then that place doesn't get planted, or gets planted in such a way that it leaves room for a tree that's a setback planting. So there are places where trees that aren't full scale are in small tree belts, hoping that someday maybe it'll be a setback planting. Different considerations that have taken on a great deal of it. So there's a lot of thought, and yet I think there are errors in any case. Partly, you know,
it's just a matter of spending time and just,
yeah.
I mean, it's really what it amounted to, was trying to crunch. It's crunching in a lot of stuff, not having the proper stock, you know, I mean, it's just a whole bunch of little factors which we're all aware of, and it's a learning.
It's our first time doing this. I feel, you know, that it's a net huge success, so I hope you know that. I just also think that we need to, since we're on the steep part of our learning curve, take away those learning lessons so that we improve the next time.
I think it's possible stock will plague us for some time. I mean, it's not totally easy to solve.
No, I mean,
even if we've been earlier.
Yeah, I think what would be helpful is once we establish a nursery or establish a process to actually get the tree stock that we want, mm-hmm. then we won't be at the whim of necessarily buying nursery stock and maybe not getting the right answers mm-hmm. exactly what, you know, what cultivar this particular species, so on
yeah,
and so forth.
Right.
I think that's a problem that Jay's identified clearly mm-hmm. that's been an issue in the past.
Thought we're getting straight species. And
yeah,
stuff.
And we've got all these weird.
Right. Yep.
Yep.
And so.
Now we know to ask.
Well, we know to ask, and then we actually probably know to do a little more research, but we're going to have to do that kind of stuff for the next few years until we actually mm-hmm. get a nursery that's actually ready to be transplanted.
Right. Because Mike came up in our conversation.
Yeah.
Because even when I asked,
I just want to make sure that we let him finish his chair report, and then we come back to this conversation.
Well, I just want to say, even when asking, the wrong answer sometimes comes out.
It's true.
Well, I mean, it did. I actually asked, and I got an answer,
yeah.
and then went back and had another conversation, and it turned out that the first was wrong.
So I don't really have enough report. Now that the tree crew is a little there. Tony's still in the metals, grading the metals roads right now, and two of the other guys had to leave for family issues, and one of the other guys went home to bed because he's working tonight. So today didn't work out. I apologize for the short notice, but they'll be here on the 16th. Is that our second?
That's what you said.
Yeah.
The Trico works at night.
They're actually going around and they're using the tree truck to hang the holiday decorations in the summer.
Oh.
So yeah, we do a little bit of everything.
Oh my God!
So that's the other 10% of work they do. That it's just in one big giant category. Mm-hmm. So
the boom truck.
The boom truck. Yeah. So that's really fun. Just status quo. Just doing tree work, tree trims, removals. No potential public shade tree hearings. I still have to go to 623 Kennedy Road and work with those residents. They have a plethora of trees that are city trees that they want to cut down. It's just going to be a little sticky.
Yeah.
I did have another gentleman actually who emailed me this past week and asked me to identify whether the tree in his front yard was a city tree or not, because he wants to remove it because he's putting solar panels on his house.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think this might be as rare a conversation as predicted at all.
I've had two or three of those conversations.
Yeah. Yep. That reminds me, I did have a gentleman call me. I wasn't able to talk with him, and he was supposed to call me back and didn't, but he was alarmed by the ribbons around two of the Forbes Library trees. And so I did tell them that they, and I assume that the ribbons are there because they're slated to be cut down.
I put the ribbons there for Harold's to identify the trees so they can give me a price. And it's going to be probably about $4,000.
You know, seeing the ribbons, I have to confess, made me dry mouth, especially the big one. And I just wanted to ask because, you know, once you cut down a tree, it's down forever. And that one that's enormous, the one that's set a little bit further west, is, you know, sequestering so much carbon, you just wouldn't believe it. And so I just wanted to ask, I know that the reason why it's slated to be taken down is because there are branches so high up that you can't reach them and they present a hazard. I understand that. And I'm wondering if the tree, if that particular tree, I know the other one is really in decline, if that tree is not imminently terminal, and you know, I'm not the judge of that, you guys would be, is it worth us to pay the money to have it, to have some other, you know, company with higher reaching equipment trim it up high to give it 10 more years of life?
I don't think it's got that many more years, but.
I mean, it's possible. I think once you go and trim it, we can probably get maybe a few more years out of it, but it's really been in decline badly, like in the last 3 or 4 years. It's really just kind of gone downhill and we've reduced the canopy.
You've had to trim it every year.
Yeah, we've trimmed those trees virtually every year.
Yeah.
In the past 3 years, we've been in there doing work on them. And that one in particular, because it's dropping a lot of dead wood into the street, into the sidewalk. Because before, we really didn't do a lot of with Forbes' trees. They had their own grounds crew, they had an outside contractor, and they had a tree person do all their work for them. We didn't do anything for them, but now, since probably the last 6 or 7 years, we've done most of their work. So, sure, it's possible. But the question is, how long,
you know.
And Jimmy can climb it.
He could climb all the way to the top?
He could climb it.
Well, that would be true.
I don't know if he wanted to climb, but he can climb it. But I can communicate.
You know, I don't feel comfortable. I don't feel good about asking these, you know, 11th hour what ifs. But on the other hand, it's an enormous tree, and I just put it out there because, you know, mature trees have so much more value to us than smaller ones, and we won't see a mature tree in that site for another 75 years.
Well, I think after we put a little package together, in which we really haven't had a chance to talk about what we're going to do for replacement trees, if we haven't got that far, and go back and talk to the trustees, once they hear that it's going to cost $4,000 to cut down 2 trees, and that's just for the crane. You know, I don't know, and the DPW, I don't think, can absorb that at this point. I don't think it would be right, actually. I think there's got to be some kind of work between the trustees and maybe the mayor's office to come up with the money, but
I can assure you that trim a tree that size would also cost that.
Yes, it would. Because we would probably end up actually having to have Jimmy probably go in the crane bucket to do the trim work. Mm-hmm. And then everything would have to be roped out of there if he doesn't feel comfortable climbing it because of its height. But depending on who does the work, if they contract it out. So I don't know, there's a couple variables that can be looked at.
I know we've discussed this before. I'm just curious, do we feel pretty sure that the reason those trees are dying is because of the root damage? And has there been anything proactive done to prevent that from happening again, either there at Forbes or elsewhere in the city? Because it's a very costly mistake.
It is a costly mistake. What I've done going forward is that every trench permit that I sign, because I also sign all the trench permits that are given to businesses this year, our trench permit season is almost over. I'm going to look at them and actually implement there's a checkbox in the back that requires that I would check off a particular box that says the contractor is held to this. And one of them is going to be, you know, ANSI 300 Part 5, which is tree protection. And so that contractor has to do everything they possibly can to follow the ANSI standards for tree protection while doing the work. And then that's going to require me or someone who's an arborist to follow up with them and do an inspection to the work site to make sure that they are doing the proper tree protection. Because even on King Street, for example, we hired a contractor to fix the sanitary sewer main, and I was watching them and how close they were to the small trees that are planted in the tree belt in front of the Leah group that had a mini excavator right up against the side of a tree. You know, so there's no These are all things that I'm learning as I'm going along and have to be implemented in our processes at DPW to kind of regulate how contractors work around the city right away. And that's really where my jurisdiction is as the tree warden and the highway superintendent. I can't really do it on private property, but trench permits are also required in Massachusetts for people that are working on private property. It's an MGL statute. So that would be where I would catch that. And I just did a few of those, and I actually wrote my own checkbox and then checked it. And then I made the office call the contractor to make sure that they're aware of it. And if they needed the information, that they were to come and see me, and I would give them the information. So.
What about building permits too with a construction site plan?
That would be, no matter what happens on public property, that once a permit's issued, they have to circle around and they have to get a trench permit from us, and that's where that would kick in. But that's where I would think the building permit would have that information once the significant tree ordinance is passed, then that would be embedded into that processes. The only question is that I don't know what the enforcement's gonna be.
Yeah.
The building commissioner would enforce anything that happens on private property, and then I would enforce anything that happens on public property through MGL Chapter 87 or the city's trench permit process or driveway permits. They're a combination.
I'm more talking about, from my understanding of that situation, I know just managing the construction on the courthouse lawn. I mean, you can have storage containers, you know, large piles of debris, construction materials, you know, for an extended period of time, especially in the summer. So that's not gonna be, you know, there's no trench permit for that type of stuff. That's all in a building permit situation with a, you know, construction plan.
I've just written up plans for Smith for contractors, what they have to do when they're on our property, the specs for trees, and the fact that none of that material can go on that site.
Right.
You have to put up fences, so.
But not by city law.
Well, I don't know if you want to incorporate something like that on city property.
Well, that would be where my jurisdiction would be, and that's where it would end. I don't have jurisdiction on private property through any ordinances with the exception of the actual trench permit.
So do we need to create then a form with check boxes for the building inspector? Is that what we're saying?
I think that he systematically goes through.
We're getting a little off topic, so I just want to make sure that we, but it sounds like we need somebody to hold this piece.
I think it would be a conversation to have with the building inspector, because really what it does is it's going to take any ordinances that we have in relation to planning on private property are enforceable. The question is that are we going to put it right in the permit itself so the actual contractor can see it, and who is going to follow up with the contractor to make sure they're doing that work? And I don't necessarily think there's enough staff in the building department to do that. So that is a conversation I think we should have, another conversation we should have with the building inspector.
Okay.
To communicate with him. And then the interim, on my end, I will do what I think is appropriate on our own trench permits, because I can add and delete things to them. I don't typically add, but add that information that this will, for example, our driveway permits, now it says right on the front, no public shade trees, we've got them on the public right away, in big italicized bold letters, according to chapter, NGL chapter 87, tree warden is responsible for making this call, blah, blah, blah. I don't really remember the total wording. And so that's right on the front. So everyone that comes in and gets one of those things sees that, so we won't have another incident like we did at 191 Spring Street.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So,
in reference to what?
I want to spend maybe another minute or two on this.
Sure.
But, and then I want to kind of circle back to the question of the Forbes trees, because that was how we kind
Correct.
Of circled
Correct.
Back to the, how we came into this conversation. And then I want to move on to our discussion about the various options for sourcing trees.
In reference to what Todd said on public, like the courthouse yeah. where they're fixing the steps, in our bid package, maybe this is similar to what you did, I was asked to write a little paragraph that was like a sheet in every bid package that goes out
yeah.
that says, you know, if there are trees in the work area, this is how far you have to, we care about them, and blah, blah, blah. You know, it was pretty weak, but yours is probably a little more specific, but I think it's at least raised awareness even among our own staff, you know?
Yep, that's how the Pulaski Park documents were written. So Stephen Stimson, who's the primary architect, wrote the actual draft document, and in there is all about tree protection, and it refers to ANSI 300 everywhere. And then he was out here on Monday, and I walked around with him as an inspection, and he was calling the contractor out on some issues that had to do with trees, so he's very, very good. So that would be a good example for us to follow in the public sector, because we can use that language. The private sector is all about what the private person wants, and it's the only teeth that we have is the actual ordinances that are related to planning and development.
Yeah.
And so that's where those teeth have to be sunk, and then there has to be a way to enforce that.
Okay, so to wrap this up, because we want to wrap it up, I think we need to go back to the idea of somebody on this committee holding that piece and really carrying it forward, like at every meeting, looking for opportunities to revise or create a new ordinance that is going to further protect trees, that either through the permitting process or whatever, it just lends more clarity and guidance for tree protection during the permitting process. So do we have that person? Todd, was that you?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, all right. So maybe I'll ask you at next meeting to kind of create some structure around this topic. I don't know even know what that sentence means, except for you're going to be thinking about it.
You write that down.
But really, I mean, we've got to just sort of, we've got to wrestle these beasts and like try to chunk them down to attainable tasks. And I want all of you to feel ownership over some of these beasts. And that means creating like, you know, a timeline, short and long-term goals, and all of that sort of thing.
But that is suggestive. Why don't, Rich, you send that information you have for Pulaski Park?
Yep.
To Todd, and I'll send the stuff I have and you have. Mm-hmm. We still have something to work with.
Good.
So
okay. And before we move on, just because we did start this conversation by me leaping over the potential cutting down of the enormous Forbes lottery tree, can you two just be thinking about whether or not we want to present to the Forbes trustees an array of options? This is how much this will cost, this is what it will look like. This is how much this will cost, this is what it will look like. And maybe you also be thinking about whether or not you would even advise them to trim that one larger tree for a period of time, or whether in your estimation it is so imminently terminal it's just not worth the time and money. In which case, I'll accept that. But if there's doubt in your mind, then I think that we should give them options, because you know, that is an enormous tree, and once it's down forever.
If those trees end up having to come down over time or whatever, is there a way we can inform the public proactively, I don't know what that would be, about why it happened? Because I think, you know, I don't know if the Forbes would let us put a little poster on the doorway, this is the reason why those trees are coming down. Or there's some public way, because I think a lot of people use that library who know nothing about trees and know nothing about construction, and even a lot of people who do construction, I mean, it's just not on people's radar because they're not trained in that, you know. So I think the more public awareness we can have, let's say a homeowner has a deck put on, you know, and somebody, or whatever, they want to put a new gas line into their house, whatever, you know, they can be, oh wait, that happened to the Forbes tree, is that going to happen to my tree, you know what I mean?
I think it's a really great idea. Yeah, I think we should give some thought to that. I think it's a huge educational opportunity. They're such public trees.
Yes.
They're such beloved trees, and we are going to hear a lot of sadness about them going.
And rather than blame, you know, oh, the DPW, always, you know, whatever, you know, misinformation. You know what I mean? I mean, there's always misinformation.
Always the DPW.
You know, I mean, you know, let's like get out in front of it and say, this is really why this happened. And the construction happened X number of years before.
Yeah.
So people never connect those two.
Yeah, right. Okay.
Well, I think we talked about that briefly when we met with them, about doing some kind of a public outreach where the patrons of the library can see exactly what Smith, what Forbes was planning on doing with the trees, and then actually possibly writing an op-ed piece or releasing a press release of some sort, just so the public knows what's going on. We're just not over there one day to cut the trees.
Right, right.
Or really the reason, I'm more after like why it happened, you know?
Yeah, I agree.
That's good.
Okie dokie. Well, hopefully that's a little bit down the road, but yes, we agree, that's an excellent idea.
When are they scheduled to be taken down?
At this moment, they're not, because we have to go back to the trustees with an actual plan of what we think would work, because they kind of asked us to help them with selecting trees that would do well, given the site constraints that we have over there, plus some assistance in how we're gonna get the trees down if that's the case. So I think the selection part we'll have to work on and sit down, and then as far as taking the trees down, the finances are really gonna be involved with just the crane, the wood and everything, and the labor will be by the city, because it is city property. But it's the other things that have to be done. So I don't anticipate they'll be cut down anytime soon, in my opinion, until we come up with a plan to share with them. And if they approve it, great. If they want to amend it, great. Whatever they want to do, we'll work with them. Am I speaking on the turn? I don't think, am I?
No.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. All right. Okay, so with this time on the agenda, when we would have had the tree crew here, I would like to have a conversation. I'm going to broaden it a little bit, because I think that I too narrowly shaped this conversation as to talk about bare root planting or sourcing bare root trees. But what I'm really realizing is we need to create a chart for ourselves of all the possible ways of sourcing trees and the pros and cons of all of them. And you know, and there might be a pro in one situation and a con in a different. And just having that piece of information all in front of us, so that when we put together a particular planting plan for a given year, we're making the best choices. So, bare root sourcing is one of them, creating our own nursery is another, sourcing at local nurseries is a third, you know, there are many. So I kind of open this up more broadly than I originally said I would. Okay, floor is open.
So I just want to say that I really think that relying on a municipal nursery would be a good thing. I think the amount of time it takes to plan to develop a nursery, I think it gives you sort of a long-term, I guess, sense of security over what your stock is going to be, what it's going to look like, what you can actually deliver. You know, if you plan on something, you can actually know you're going to have it. And also, it might act as like a insurance, you know, if an example of, you know, funding not being as readily available for purchasing trees, you know, 10, 15 years from now. I think having sort of a long-term rotating plan, while there's interest and while there's a pretty good location that's been staked out, I think having that as a goal would be something worth pursuing really vigorously. Regarding like bare root stock, I've heard like mixed results on that. I don't think it's appropriate for a street tree setting or for street tree planting, just based upon the abuse it may or may not take from just kind of in general, snow plows, people. It'd be interesting to see how many trees that we planted survive, you know, whether snowfall takes them out or the contractor takes them out or somebody just had that day. You know, because I experienced, you know, mortality based upon that, and those were large B&B trees. So
can I just ask, is that anecdotal or is that research based?
It's within my own sort of like human data, you know, based on like this tree coming down with this cause. So those are large trees. And those are, you know, bald burlap trees. And I don't know if like bare root would work in an urban setting. I think it would work for private property, yeah.
Well, did you have a chance to watch that video from Cornell? Because they say that it's excellent for urban setting. It's got a higher survivability rate for
them. Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I've seen umbrella trees, I've seen, you know, the grow bag trees, I've seen whips. Urban environments are really tough on trees, you know, and I don't know if it's just survivability. I think it's just, I think you want to have something that's hardy and durable that you can plan on. And I think in the interim, I really think it'd be worth like pursuing it as one option of piloting to see if it'll work. And I totally think Cornell is a good source, and I'm not doubting it, but I think, you know, having sort of a mixed approach would be much more beneficial, you know.
Well,
from my standpoint,
I think what you're touching on is that we wouldn't want to decide that's how we're going to do a year's planting and do it bare root without trying it first. So if we were to move ahead, we would want to get 20 or whatever, or some number of bare root trees and see what happens.
Yeah. Also, it's like you're planting like, you know, 10, 15 years on the horizon, you know, relying on that supplier always being available. And I don't know. I mean, it's like a new way of doing things. Maybe more people will be doing it, but you know, it is like a long-term strategy that you're trying to make sure you have what you're looking for, you know, next decade.
Okay.
I think up until I looked at this video, not the Cornell video, but the nursery video, where they actually follow Cornell's plan and give you a B&B or a bare root with the treated with gelscape and send it to you that way. I've never seen bare root tree come with such a nice root system as that nursery had. They had a good selection of plant material too, which surprised me.
And that was their short list. They'll have a much bigger list in the spring.
So I think it's definitely something that we really need to consider. I've never seen that selection and that good quality bare root material available before. So they're following the Cornell plan, and I think using that material, if there's other nurseries with that quality material, I think it'd be worth going with. But I think where having our own nursery would be good is it would broaden our selection of material. Mm-hmm. They had a good selection there, better than most nurseries I've seen. But there's also other things that we could add to that. So we might want a smaller nursery, something of that nature, where we could get harder to find things. I don't know how many trees we need to buy.
Didn't talk about a minimum.
Okay.
We're on their route for going to the Boston area.
And I think maybe a combination. I think the grow bags are a good idea. And I think, you know, working with local nurseries in that area too, I think we could do a nice combination.
Mm-hmm. We could use grow bags in our nursery too.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, I think it's going to come down to money, as most things do. And I think looking long term, you know, we may not always have this mayor or a mayor that, you know, puts tens of thousands of dollars into budget for street trees. So I think we have to create a long term strategy based on, you know, becoming self-sufficient at some point in the future. And presenting, you know, that and those options, because, you know, the investment in a municipal nursery is going to cost money as well. So looking at our options and planning a long-term kind of structure based on fiscal sustainability in the long run, I think is a good direction to head.
So when you say sustainability, you don't necessarily mean reliance only on our own tree stock, but you just mean financial.
I mean, assuming that at some point the 30 grand a year will go away.
Do you think it would be expensive once we establish the nursery to keep it going? Is that what you're saying? Or
no, I think, well, to set it up is going to, you know, your startup costs are going to be
right.
High.
But after it started, once
and
it
after
started.
Yeah, so obviously there's going to be a curve and then there'd be other curve. And then assuming, you know, looking at it from a fine and donation point of view and having that grow and eventually take over. I just think that the money side of it has to, you know, be very strongly tied to whatever decisions we make on BB versus bare root versus
But that would kind of tie in with what Andrew said, to secure your supply when you're on nursery, because that would be probably, once it's established, the lowest cost way of getting a tree, possibly.
I just want to make sure I give other people a chance to chime in. Do you have some thoughts? I know you had said you had some research.
Yeah, I have not. When I first heard about this berry planting, I was like, you've got to be kidding me. No, it's ridiculous. And these are big trees, you know, these are up to 2-inch caliper. They're not little. Yeah, no, they're big. And so I did a little bit of research, and I brought some, you know, I don't have any personal experience planting them. I know that in Springfield, Mass Mutual had a combination weekend thing where some of my students went to help, and they planted some of these bare root trees in a park that was tornado. I could probably find out. I couldn't go that weekend, so I didn't do it. But I brought two documents. If people want them, I mean, if you don't want them, don't take them. But I, there's one is this booklet from Cornell on the bare root system, and then there's this other one from UMass just on their own. So we can just pass them around. If you want one, take one. If you don't, I can recycle them.
I know
it's
that,
also
I know
digital
that.
On digital.
Yeah, it's at the Urban Horticulture.
Urban Horticulture Institute is the Cornell, and it's they have several videos that are quite good about it.
Yeah, so, I mean, the one I linked to is excellent, and the thing that I just wanted to say, which I was very surprised about, was that they showed the method of removing and balling and burlapping a tree versus the method of extracting a tree out of the ground for bare root. And then what they did was then they took the ball and burlap and took it out of its soil and showed what the size of its root system was, and it was a fraction of the size of this tree. So when we talk about survivability, it's just, that's why they're more, even in cities, situations, because they have a much bigger root system.
It's a bigger coordination. I mean, I think I agree with Andrew that in the long run, I think security and just being able to have the varieties we want, you know, and maybe as some folks hear about these newer varieties that may be fabulous and we can't get them because they're bought out, you know, we could get the whips or, you know, I think it'd be good to have a combination, but I mean, this is interesting to me. And I didn't know there was a, because it's near Buffalo is where the nursery is, I think.
Yeah, it's way
so it's a, it's be a haul to go, because you used to have to go pick them up yourself.
Yeah.
No, you know?
Also really light, and so without the root ball, they're extremely light, so you can bring more.
We plant a lot of them that people can plant them. And the one comment that I've heard over and over is that it's a rare time that you plant it too deep, because it's just,
you know, easy.
But I don't have personal experience.
So I think if we ever do our own nursery, I don't think we should ever try to do a B&B system.
No.
I think the grow bags are like the perfect balance between giving you good roots that are entirely intact and easy for people to move without heavy machinery. I've been very happy with those. You know, the roots are usually intact. I don't like the mesh bags because the roots grow through. But the felt bags, you know, I never see any circling. I never see any root bound, and the root structure is really good. So I think, for our own standpoint, I think it'd be cool if we pursued that sort of like felt grow bag system. And I think it would be good if we could. In the interim, when you're thinking about, you know, purchasing trees, you're talking about 7-8 years away. If you plant something now, that would actually be harvestable. So it's 7 or 8 years of planting, of trying out new approaches. So just even just for our own standpoint, just doing like little pilot programs and saying how does this, you know, sort of tranche perform compared to other, you know, segments of the planting zone. You know, I think that would be beneficial going forward, not only for ourselves but like internal policy, but as a way of trying new things out. But I really have never, ever, ever think we should ever try to do a B&B system. I'm not happy with the roots.
Okay.
But,
I would like to explore more whether cities larger than ours maintain or have chosen not to maintain their own nurseries. I mean, we do not have an urban forestry department. So I want us to be really realistic about what a city our size should take on and what is the best use of our resources. And I'm very compelled by the let's be self-sufficient and, you know, let's have our own control. But if other cities our size and larger are making decisions, are making rational decisions not to have nurseries, I think we should explore it before we decide to launch forward with the nursery. And again, I say this because I ran a on-the-ground project where the actual implementation of managing a site proved vastly, vastly more time-consuming than one would have predicted.
I think when I launched into like whole nursery argument for myself, I didn't think there was any reason at all to have your own stock. That was until I was dealing with purchasing from multiple vendors, never really being happy with what I was getting. Because you know, you're like, all right, I don't want 80 oaks, but I can get 80 oaks. Mm-hmm. You know, like that's what I'm getting this spring, I'm getting 80 oaks, mm-hmm. you know. Because for different procurement rules, you work with who you have, right? And sometimes it's dissatisfying to be really excited and you're like, oh, great, this is what I've got, you know. And it's not because it's a lack of money, it's just supply is sometimes tight. You know, you have a hard winter like this year and people can't dig stuff out of the ground. And next thing you know, it's like you've got like 4 weeks to plant all your trees and all you can dig is mm-hmm. something that's kind of less than stellar. So I think initially I was like, whatever, it's $200 per tree, $250 per tree. You can just buy whatever you want anyway. But I guess what I'm saying is like you can't buy whatever you want, you know, and that sometimes supplies just don't work out. And I think mm-hmm. maybe the hydrogel thing might be a cool solution. But
and they're really cheap.
Yeah.
Well, in terms of the city nursery, I think, you know, just going back, you know, there's other ways to skin the cat that, you know, the DPW or volunteers does not have to weed whack and take care of the nursery. I still think it's worth exploring the possibility of leasing out city property to a private nursery vendor and setting up standards under which the city mm-hmm. gets X percentage of the stock that the city gets to kind of dictate, but the private sector vendor who's leasing the property gets to control the rest and sell it. And we could also create a regional co-op with a lot of the smaller towns that have no ability to ever grow their own trees and have the nursery sell directly to them.
But Linda's now kind of worried about that too. So I went to Springfield to see how they run their nursery, and it's pretty easy. They just basically mow the grass and that's it. Like when it comes,
they don't water.
Well, I guess there's irrigation. Mm-hmm. So I built in like an irrigation system to mine, you know, so I just like turn on the faucet and turn it on.
If you have grow bags, you get a drip irrigation and you get someone looking at that, you know, it's not a mow situation.
Well, I've got drip irrigation, I've got like lines and it's all kind of planned out. And I feel good about the drip irrigation and you just mow in between.
You got to spray it. There is a lot of stuff that gives it, they do more than just mow it. Yeah. More the things that's going to get infested and die.
Yeah, and then like control for like, you know, rodents occasionally, but so far it's been pretty easy. You know, I mean, I probably spend 2 hours a week working on it.
Well, what stage is your
round one? You know, like 3 years from now, I might hate it, but you know.
Whatever. What do you have? What do you have? Little trees?
Yeah, small trees. You know.
Right.
Small trees. So.
And you planted whips or something?
No. I think I got $25 trees from Iglo, so they were in like 3 gallon pots, I think. So, but the next round's going to be whips, so mm-hmm. mortality can be higher. But I really like originally I was like, oh, it's going to be a hassle. It's not that hard. It's like really not that hard.
It sounds like it could be a good way to get Smith Voc and other area schools and organizations involved to do some of the labor.
Yeah.
And maybe if we go into it with the intention of, all right, this is our pilot, you know, like document it really well, what worked well, what didn't, it can be a good learning for ourselves as well as other communities who might be interested in
it. And the costs weren't really that high. I mean, I spent until $80,000 on something else for shipping. So when it came down to like rootstock and grow bags themselves, you're looking at net maybe $20,000 plus irrigation. So maybe $30,000 to do everything if you're not going to build fencing, which I think, you know, I think that is reasonable, you know, to have like 8 years from now some sort of stability in terms of what you're planting and getting, you know.
So I would like for us to take the time to populate a chart that lays out some of these major options and has, you know, aspects of them that are positive and, you know, tags which ones fall into those options. And I would also like to take the time to interview some people who are zoomed out further, like Molly Freilicher, to say, What is your recommendation to a municipality for sourcing trees, you know, most efficiently with the highest rate of success, you know, best use of our dollars? And really do that research and have a completely open mind before, after this conversation, I think they're all good options, but I still don't feel like I have enough information. And so I would just like to take the time to do a little bit more research. Does anyone want to take part in that research, that information gathering with me? Okay, so maybe we can think about who we want to contact. And I just feel like this stage of the planning is the most important part, because, you know, once you start going down a particular road, it's a little bit harder to change direction.
Yeah, but I get the feeling that you want the hydrogel solution, which kind of seems like a waste of exercise if you just want people to reach that conclusion, you know?
No, yeah. I don't. I'm honestly saying I am open to all. Mm-hmm. And so I can even hand that piece of like researching more about Bear Roof to somebody else. And I usually ask open-ended questions, like if I were to ask Molly, I wouldn't say, wow, I'm really turned on to Bear Roof tree planting. You know, can you give me 10 reasons why I should pitch it to my tree committee? I'm going to ask her the question of like, for a municipality our size, this is the amount of money we have now, but we don't know what the future will hold. You know, what would be the best way for us to be thinking about sourcing trees? What are the best options?
Do you have a very minor breakdown of the budget?
I gave it to Rich.
Oh, Rich has it. Yeah.
Okay, so Jay, you want to help out with looking into that a little more? Are there any other, so we've heard sourcing or having our own city nursery, and I've heard most people say they would like to use the grow bag method. Sourcing from local nurseries, like when I say local, I kind of mean statewide. And then sourcing from regional nurseries, and if we were going to go regional, it would probably be Bear Roof. And then I heard from Todd about a notion of having a private sector vendor lease city land with the exchange of them providing some trees for the purpose of, for as city trees. Did I get that part right? I don't even know where to begin with that piece, personally. I would turn to somebody else to investigate that.
It's important to have in there that there's Bear Roof, Grow Bag, B&B, in other words.
I haven't heard anyone say they want to pursue B&B.
No.
So maybe we won't even talk about B&B.
Not for our own use, and I'd like to get away from buying B&B we all saw the issues.
Yeah. It was exhausting working with B&Bs.
The best part is they're not going to tip over when snow plows goes by. Other than that, mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
You can tie up a small tree.
You get Bear Roof, once you water it in, and once that dries out, that's pretty stable.
Yeah.
So, are there any other options that I've missed here that we should be exploring? Anyone else want to be involved in any of the research?
I'd be interested.
I'm going to be involved in a couple of thoughts.
Okay. Do you want to express them now?
Well, they relate to it. They're just different versions of that. But I still think there's something there with the regional approach and using it as a revenue generator at the end of the day.
Oh, you mean us having a nursery and selling the stock?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll put that in as a note. Or is that a subset of the city nursery?
It could be tied to the private sector idea, or it could not be. Private sector idea is to get rid of a lot of the upfront costs and ongoing maintenance. And
okay.
Maybe a regional nursery? Think that's a feasibility?
I can work with Rich and kind of explore that. I mean, I could explore it from
even
the COG point of view.
Us hosting a regional nursery that other municipalities would
purchase from.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Get some trees planted in the hilltop.
Is there rules about non-competitive, like I know when I worked at the Volk School, like we were limited in what we could kind of do, like in that realm, you know, like if we were having a plant sale or something, we couldn't advertise, for example, like we, the volume had to be, you know, because now you're competing with, I like the idea, but now, I was just came in my head, now you're competing with Amherst Nursery, you're competing with, you know, the city is, there's no rules about that, I think.
Okay. Anything else before we move on to the next topic? All right.
Well, I would highly recommend going on that website, the Urban Horticulture website, and looking at the videos.
I'll be there on Thursday.
I'll see you. Good.
Thanks. It should be interesting.
All right,
Yes.
Online survey?
All righty. Okay, as an update, thanks to Rich for helping me to get the full results, because the status of SurveyMonkey had switched, so I can only access the first 100. So we have 381 respondents from the online survey, and then a dozen or so paper versions. Myra's gonna help with this project, so thanks. So I just followed up with Lily just to get a sense of time frame and expectations. So I feel quite confident that by early March we'll have like this all wrapped up. I'm actually hoping to have the first version of this report done by the end of 2015, and then at the beginning of the year we can review it and do any tweaking or editing of the report itself. But yeah, I think it's, you know, it's a 10-question survey, and there's a good combination of just sort of yes-no questions as well as written responses, and yeah, I think there's a lot to glean. So if you have any questions as to, you know, in the next 5 or so weeks, let me know, but otherwise I'm going to start with Martin's help to start mining the data.
Can I ask now, when you come across people who are volunteering, I think there was money, time, watering. There were several categories.
Education.
What are you aggregating or putting on a list, or are you doing anything with that information? Or do you want
to? If I hear the question correctly, so as I'm looking at the answers, is there going to be any follow-up process for people who have expressed interest?
Well, yeah, I mean, I assume that we'll follow up, but I'm just wondering if maybe I should separately be trying to accumulate, you know, read over each one and write down a spreadsheet of what people.
I will gladly send you the PDF version of all 10 questions that.
I actually.
Sounds like you've already downloaded.
I got those. I just haven't done anything with them.
Okay.
And I'm just thinking that maybe I should deal with that question.
Please feel free to look at them. If you have any questions, we can collaborate on any of those answers.
Okay. Well, I guess what I'll do is I'll probably categorize them, like what people were interested in participating, and then if it probably acknowledge at some point, maybe with the help of Lily or even their interest.
Are you downloading this to a CSV file? So that you can categorize things and do keyword searches and
I haven't, but
I think
haven't done
surveying.
Help
you organize and manipulate the data a lot more easily. I don't know. I haven't looked at the way they have you what tools they already have online for organizing the data, but it's pretty, I think it's pretty aggregate. Like they're not, they're giving you like X percent of people chose number one at, you know, chose the benefit of shade for the reason why they like trees as their number one choice. You know, that kind of thing, as opposed to giving you a, more detailed, especially in those text boxes where people are writing down like their vision of it, of where they want our tree program to be in 20 years. That's going to require you to really kind of dig deeply.
Yeah, and when I've analyzed SurveyMonkey surveys before, I haven't used any special software. I've used the mechanisms of analysis that SurveyMonkey provides, as well as just my own thinking brain, like, you know, clustering things and sort of, you know, making my own deductions from replies. But if there's some more sophisticated data, I'd be happy to, or software, I'd be happy to run it through and see if it means anything further than what I am doing on my own.
Okay. You know what? I would love to meet you once.
Okay.
To sit down and look at this, both on SurveyMonkey and maybe download it as a CSV file.
Okay.
And maybe help think about some, and you're going to be part of this, right? Think about some of the questions, some of the things we're trying to glean. We're trying to glean some very, very big picture stuff, like what are we hearing as the common themes about a vision in 20 years?
Yep.
That's one of them. And then others, like, what, you know, who are the people that want to donate money or that want to... volunteer time or whatever. So it was a combination of getting big picture stuff in.
Okay.
So I'll wait, and hopefully you can either say, oh, that volunteer part, you know, someone to just go through it by hand, like me, or that maybe you guys will be able to somehow organize.
Give you a list.
Yeah, organize it. I mean, I have actually pulled out everyone who offered to volunteer something. I have a separate PDF file.
It's only in PDF. That's a shame.
I mean, well, that's, I think, how it ended up.
Okay. It's just that you want to be able to organize that in an Excel spreadsheet or something.
Right, I don't have that.
Okay. All right. So we'll look at that.
Okay. All right. Yeah, I think that's important, because I do have a little bit of concern that we ask people, hey, do you want to volunteer?
Yeah.
And
then there's no follow-up.
Yeah.
Right.
And that's like, if that's we're trying to build, trying to build a group of volunteers, we got to figure that out. I'm not saying we need to know what to do now, but we need to, like, button that up.
I've already sampled, like, sent out emails to four people who volunteered just to find out what that meant. You know, like, are they ready? They're standing around with shovels or whatever. And I got a pretty good response.
Mm-hmm.
So I do want, I'm with Jan, I want to respond to them soon.
December 12th is when the SurveyMonkey is
going. Yeah. Well, yeah.
So we opened it once already.
Yeah, we don't need to reopen it again.
No,
I think it's
open now for you to look at all the data, the raw data that's there. But I got it downloaded into an Excel spreadsheet.
Yeah, and I've done that once, but I think we've gotten a few more surveys in since then, so we'll do it again, and then. All right, thank you. And so maybe tonight after the meeting, you and I will come up with a date on the calendar, the three of us. Okay, so I have on, as an agenda item, the topic of volunteer coordination, because I feel like, you know, I'm sure you guys are wanting to take a big exhale because you did a lot of volunteer coordination. And in some ways, you put in your time. On the other hand, I think it's very it's very tempting, but ultimately not wise to think the trees are in the ground, our job is done, when we really need to get to have a really careful plan of having those trees watered in the spring, and getting volunteers to help is huge. So that's the adopt a tree part of this. And then I just wanted to check in with you guys about with the remaining 30 trees. It's, we've touched upon that a little bit in Rich's report, but what, you know, whether Smith Folk students are going to be helping with that, or just like what the status of that is. And then spring planting. Like, do we, you know, it feels early. On the other hand, we want to start early so that we aren't scrambling, and that we have a well-conceived plan for the spring. Maybe even like just to say, this month is the month we're going to be doing it, and start getting that on everybody's calendar.
I think from a coordination standpoint, doing all the planning in 1 month is a little too difficult.
Well, but it might be just the 40 trees that we have.
Right, so basically what we have to do is we have to determine, we have 40 trees left to plant, so we have to plant all those trees in the spring.
So that could be 1 month that we do the 40 trees.
That could be 1 month, that'd be very easy to do that. But I also think that we need to also think about fall planting next year, and then trying to stagger some fall planting. So that's a conversation piece that we'll have to have this winter to try to figure out what is going to be the best plan for us to work to plant the same amount of trees. But then the other issue too is, we don't know if we end up getting approval for the tree inventory, then there goes a good chunk of the money for tree planting. It's in that $40,000 line item that we have in the DPW budget. But there also brings another conversation with the mayor about funding the tree inventory from somewhere else possibly. So there's a couple different options financially. So to try to keep that money in place all the time, to have trees to be planted every year, I think is important.
Let me ask you this though, does that money have to be used exclusively for buying tree stock? I mean,
no.
Okay, so for example, if we do go forward with a nursery on some level, that money could go toward an irrigation system?
Absolutely. Yep. Okay. It's all related to any kind of trees, shrubs.
What about maintenance, like identifying some specimen trees that could really use some maintenance?
That would come out of that budget as well.
Okay.
So really the way the budgets work is that every line item has X amount of dollars in it. But the way that we are set up, it's the bottom line is that what matters. So I can overexpend a line item by $10,000 to $20,000, providing I have it in my bottom line. So if we end up not expending all the OM money at the end of the fiscal year, then there's that extra pot of money at the end. So more monies can be shifted. So you can transfer monies within a budget as long as it doesn't leave that particular OM budget. Makes any sense.
So what is Owen?
Ordinary maintenance.
Okay.
So pruning, where does pruning come in?
Pruning is not really anything that's, there is not any monies associated with it. It's only personal services.
Personal services.
So there's two different budgets. We have a personal services budget for the highway division, which includes the tree crew, myself, wherever else in the highway division. And then we have an OM budget. The OM budget is for materials, supplies, fuel, trees, street signs, guardrails, pothole, blacktop, you name it. It's all comes out of this big budget that's probably almost $1 million. And then personal services is a separate budget that pays for all of our salaries. So when we go to prune a street tree, we actually know how much it costs because View Works breaks that down for us, our work order system. And that money comes from personal services, which is already built in. So it doesn't come from the OM. The OM budget is to buy just the materials or repairs to the tree truck or the chipper or one of the loaders that we use, something of that nature.
So going back to the volunteer issues, do you think I know people are pretty skeptical about volunteers, but even on small trees, 10-foot trees, little ones, some of the small trees in particular do need some pruning. So that might just happen with the tree crew, or do you think there's any possibility
I think there's a possibility, but I think the folks that are going to do pruning have to be trained.
Yeah.
And they really ought to be monitored by at least one certified arborist.
Right.
Because, I think it would be great to have people, if we have brigades of people that wanted to prune trees they could reach properly.
Yeah.
But I think there has to be, similar to doing the tree planting, we have to have some kind of system where, people actually are monitored. And then if there's a mistake happens, that obviously the person has to be corrected politely, and this is really the right way to do it, but we hope to educate people prior to that.
Well, I think doing something on the kind of scale of tree planting isn't likely with the pruning, but having an arborist go around with maybe a couple of volunteers here and there, but maybe get four or five, six community members involved to go with an arborist. The two arborists are available are Tony and you.
Yeah.
That's it, Matt?
Yes. And Jimmy's not an arborist, but Jimmy's pruned more trees than I'll ever prune in my whole life.
Oh, right.
Well, but if you put together a training on pruning, it doesn't have to be a city arborist. It could be
Jay.
It could be right. Jay. It could be Alan.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But would they, once they've been through the training, would those people going out pruning need to have Jay with them?
No, they could sign a liability. I mean, other municipalities give them...
I'm just saying the model of the planting was that we did have them with us.
Not necessarily. One thing I'd be afraid of is that if there's no one...
They're not climbing trees.
They're not climbing trees, but I'm afraid of conflicts with residents. That's the only thing I'm concerned about, because when you have a DPW truck pull up and the tree truck pulls up and you're trimming a tree, there's really absolutely no question in anyone's mind. And when we were doing the tree plantings, there was really, we were out there, we staked everything out, and then we fought our battles as we went. If there were any, which there were only a couple. But it was done in such a way that there was no disruption to the volunteers. I mean, I had a really bad experience on Forbes Avenue where the volunteers basically were like, okay, we're out here. They moved down the street that way. And I just don't want folks who are volunteering to do tree pruning to run into the same problem. And there's no city staff around, or there's no certified person to go over and talk to the homeowner and say, no, this is what they're doing. So I'm not...
I don't think it's as potentially a volatile situation as someone taking a few small... I mean, we're really talking about things that you can do with hand...
Well, it's also different because when you're planting, you can't retreat as easily, whereas when you're pruning, you can say, okay.
You can run, right?
Yeah.
I give up on all your tools in your pocket, basically.
I think we might be anticipating a problem that's not...
Yeah, okay, so would you like maybe to have me kind of think about how I would get volunteers together and we would do this in some way?
I think there are a number of things, and I don't know if this means that you need more support, but I'm seeing, sure, pruning I think is a neat one. You have one volunteer who's really ready to sign up for that. And then you've got to think about what the plan for watering these brand new trees are for the spring. And whether, you know, whether that's going to be just exclusively from the water bags, you know, that's, if we can manage that, that's fine. But, you know, we just want to ensure that these trees get watered all through the summer months.
I mean, that is the fallback plan right now, is the water bags, I think.
Okay. And then what is our spring planting plan? What's the month? How are we staggering this? Where are we sourcing the trees? All of these things. I don't think that they necessarily need to all fall on you guys, because you're just the volunteer coordination part. But I do think that we need to start thinking about this. So I'm going to be putting like spring plans on the agenda every time we meet.
Well, we just from here on. Right now, just ask like Jay and Rich, like, when is a good time in the spring to plant trees? Like May? Good.
Depends on the winter.
Depends on how
as soon as you can get in the ground, it's the best time.
As soon as the ground thaws out.
Which might be April.
Typically is in March 2nd, third week of March.
Third week of March. Yeah. Last year it was third week of April.
Yeah, later. Yeah.
Exactly. Okay, the thing is...
better when they're dormant.
With volunteers, we sort of have to think of ahead in a way. We won't be able to do it, just maybe. So can we just like conceptually think of April? Would be
second half of April? That's
a little... I would say April 1st.
April,
yeah,
okay.
April 1st. I would say April 1st.
Just FYI, if we were, and this is no pressure, if we were to do the bare root with Schichtel's nursery, they do the second half of April.
Okay, when? That's when they ship?
That's when they ship.
Well, if they can dig them and ship them, we should be able to plant them because they're in Ohio.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
New York, yeah, but...
Okay, I think that just
near Buffalo.
Just for this one planting we're talking about, we're just on 40 trees that we know we already have that we probably need to plant in the spring. And it would make sense to just throw in some of the bare root ones, not very many. Maybe that same, it's the same month. So I just want to put that out there. I mean, that just because we're doing 40 bare roots doesn't mean we couldn't do a couple dozen.
You mean 40 of the...
I mean 40 of the bagged ones. We could do a couple dozen, maybe 20. That would be 60 overall, which would be 20 less than we did this fall, and we would have all winter to make sure the sites are safe.
If we have the money, though, right? We have to wait to see.
It's very little money because we're only talking about 20 bare root trees.
Yeah, we've already purchased all the other trees, so I don't anticipate a problem.
Okay.
So I'm just throwing that out. I'm only throwing it out because now I'm already thinking, okay, April, you know, has a certain format where maybe we'll be planting.
Rob, you got to check with me in the spring. I could be buried in snowbank, man.
I mean, we don't know.
Right.
Okay, well, let's think on that. that option.
Obviously, we're just thinking about it.
I just also think that there should be like prioritization, like it'd be great to be able to get volunteers to prune, but the top priority is get people to water.
Yes, I agree.
You know, we need to like.
I don't think there's any pruning that needs to take place for a year or two anyway.
Well, there are trees in my neighborhood that were planted 8 years ago, or 5 years ago, that are just like, it pains me every time I walk by. Maybe I can twist the DPW.
Yeah, but we're just talking about triage.
This is triage.
This is triage, and we have trees that will die if they don't get watered all of next season.
I can guarantee they're all, no matter what, I can't swear, but no matter what, they'll get watered, okay?
Yeah.
They'll get watered, and then what we should do is, let's go on the premise that the DPW will water these trees, but if we can make a plan of actually getting some of these trees watered by residents who want to adopt them, then we will tick those trees off the list, and those will be the adopted trees, and the DPW will water X amount of trees.
Okay, so just, how's that going to work? So how are you going to find all the, you're going to have like a list, and they're going to go tick, 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 tick off the list and drive around to each tree? And so if a tree gets watered by a resident, it comes off the list?
Yes, so we'll go check on it, but we don't have to stop and water it.
Right, okay, we'll still be checking on it, right. So I guess.
You know what this speaks to also, and I feel remiss on my part on this, because we talked about this and I didn't follow through, which was when we plant trees, we had talked about making a little door catch that says, you know, this tree has been planted, it's a city tree, it could really use your help. Could you water it, da-da-da-da, and you know, here's how much it would cost you to water this tree for the entire season. And I did get a sample of that from Worcester Tree Initiative, and I just dropped the ball. So
well,
it seems,
too late.
It's gonna be more work to have to go back to every one of those houses, and you know, we were there once. But certainly with the 40 new trees that we plant in the spring, we should be, you know, dropping literature at all of those trees to see if at all of those houses to see if people.
So because it's alligator bags, it doesn't matter people, as long as it's full, it doesn't matter who puts the water in. So if a resident fills it up, it just saves you guys time of filling it up. Is that
yeah, it's just one less tree we have to do.
But you still have to check it, right?
Well, if I know a resident, we'll probably check them in a sense. I mean, if you have one tree here, another tree here, one right here, I'm going to drive by and bag's empty two times in a row, then there's something wrong because it takes, I don't know, how long for one of those bags to empty?
A day
probably. So if you come
back. Oh, I didn't realize that. They empty in a day.
18 hours or so. Mm-hmm.
So, but we're filling them once a week, right?
No, we were filling them twice a week.
Twice a week.
It was depending on how dry it was.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay. Okay. So I guess I want you two to be thinking about what the best, you know, the best way to map out a volunteer plan for the spring.
Yeah.
And when it comes to planting, watering, and I guess we're taking pruning off the list for the short term.
Well,
I think there's two different trains of thought here.
Yeah.
Some of us are thinking about pruning the existing trees that we just planted, which, as Jay stated, you probably don't need them for at least a few years. You're talking about trees that are still reachable that were planted by you or other volunteers that are close to the people's eye level.
Yeah.
They aren't going to require like what Paige unfortunately was climbing to a snowbank.
Right.
Although she was smart to use the snowbank to her advantage because she would never got up there otherwise.
I am talking about the stuff that Paige is very.
Yeah. Okay.
And I think it would be good to identify some places where trees need to be pruned by folks that actually want to do that. And then we have to identify the trees, and then I have to just review them because according to MGL Chapter 87, nobody can touch a tree without my permission. So I just want to make sure that we follow just a little bit of just some procedures.
Okay.
But I think starting small and maybe having a few volunteers do some tree pruning just so we kind of capture that.
Okay.
And just see if, you know, how far it gets off the ground for this winter because it is a good time to prune.
So. Well, we would start with, is it Jimmy? Is it?
Yeah.
You know, with Jimmy just going out with a couple volunteers, right? I mean, whatever, or if Jay is available.
Or Tony or someone.
Or Tony, yep. You know, and just start reinforcing the activities. So.
Okay.
Paige will be really happy to hear it.
Great. Well,
I don't think it's as easy as you may think it is
to prune
a tree correctly.
Yeah.
Well, then you'd be the trainer.
Yeah, that's what we're hoping you're going to be along, and I don't want to volunteer.
There's a lot of decisions that have to be made on the spot.
Jay, you shouldn't have said anything, because now you're just got volunteer, you do.
Yeah, I mean, if we're talking about just training Paige, she has good plan sense, and she has a lot of experience with plans. So let's start small, and then... I'm happy to be trained, yeah. I mean, I took the tree stewards training.
Jen might volunteer.
Yeah, I mean, we could get a little...
That's why I think it's important, though, to identify a certain set of trees to be pruned and make it a small cluster and kind of leave it at that and let folks do that work. And we'll see how it goes.
Yeah.
And we can identify another cluster of trees. Because I don't want people, somebody over on Pleasant Street...
All over the city.
All over the place, and then I got to run everywhere to go look at all this stuff. If we have a small cluster where folks want to concentrate, then they can do whatever pruning they can reach. And then if it's a larger tree, we can assist them in going aerial if we have to or climbing. But I think it would be good to do, to keep it small to start with.
I think the best way forward, you're going to find five people want to do it.
Yep.
You train them, you basically put your stamp on them.
Yeah.
And they're allowed to just spend the winter pruning.
Trees that are identified on there.
That you identified, like be pruned, Okay, I'm going to move on, because it's time to move on. And we had agenda item fundraising options. I did forward you all the notes that I had with the director, right, from Water into Trees. And so that was a little, that was a little bit of a, I don't know, wet towel on the enthusiasm for that program. This was the city of Durham has this program called Water into Trees that apparently they've had since the early 90s, but they don't get more than a few thousand dollars every on a given year. You know, they're a municipality of 280,000 people, but it's not an advertised program. And he had some interesting thoughts. I thought I wrote them down, but no, do folks have any questions? Did you have a chance to read my notes?
So people pay their water bill and volunteer to give extra money?
Correct. In one of like four different ways, either as a one-time donation, quarterly, or rounding their bill up to the closest dollar.
I have an observation that is striking in relation to that number is that when I was going through, along with the volunteers, it's like, I'll pay, I'll give money, I'll work. There were a lot of people who were saying they would give money. I don't know what it means.
But you're talking about in our survey.
Okay. Yeah, in the survey, I was like, wow.
Oh, yeah, there's a huge latent will to invest.
Which means they're making more money than that other town you're mentioning.
Well, maybe. We've never asked before.
Right. I'm just surprised how many people said
that. Yeah, a lot of people.
Who are these people?
So it has somewhat dampened my enthusiasm to move forward with this. And he also raised a good point. He said, other organizations seeking additional funding will ask why they can't have the same program, expect this. Mm-hmm. You know, like, what makes us so special to be able to put our hand out on a piece of city literature when there are lots of other worthy, causes. Yeah. That's a reasonable question. On the other hand, it's like the squeaky wheel. That's how fundraising works. You ask, and it's the people that ask that generally bring in the funds. So that was one thing. And let's see, what else? It sounds...
There's also a rational nexus, though, to the stormwater issue.
Water, yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's true. Mm-hmm. There is. I agree. Mm-hmm. I totally agree. So there is that water connection, and I think that's why they do it in Durham, because there's a connection with Water into Trees. So it could be that they've just not administered it and marketed it well. And one of my questions was, what is the public perception of the program? He says minimal. Having the funds go to one department makes it hard to advertise because changes take place in different areas that affect the process, and it's not clearly communicated or passed on to the public. There have been frustrations all around. So, I could probably go into more depth with him, but it sounds like it had some initial enthusiasm and then just sort of petered along, because he also went on to say that for years, okay, hold on, He said, it started in the early 90s, petered out after a while with limited interest and honestly no funds being drawn. Fortunately, the funds stayed put and were not swept into the general operating budget. So that at, in the 2008 downturn, when their tree budget was completely excised, they were able to use 20 plus years of accrued funds to buy some trees. He says, we've since re-upped the program 3 years ago and it's grown from 1,000 to 3,000 a year. Still really, really paltry for the size of the town, but again, we're a different kind of town, so right. It's possible we draw in, more funds. I'm not even gonna ask us where we wanna go from here with it. Right now, just sit on it and maybe we'll circle back to this at a future meeting. I wanna make sure I have time to discuss the Friends of Northampton Trees and Trails and Greenway, but do you look like you're about to say something?
Well, just I'd be interested to know what the decision steps are with DPW on this.
For doing this?
If we decided to implement it, it doesn't sound very hard to do.
Implement what?
Sounds like it would need
water to trees first.
Well, you need the DOER, the Department of Revenue, to authorize the fund. The fund to be established by the City Council, and then blah blah blah. But at some point along the way, DPW is going to have to change the bill and have the administrator and have someone administrate.
Yeah.
You know, oh, here's $5 that goes here, the rest goes here. Oh, here's $250 that someone's going to have to do the accounting.
That may prove to be the most challenging part because the system that we use for billing is Munis. Which, from our experience with doing the latest stormwater bills, which Terry can attest to, we are pulling, or I'm not pulling my hair, but the office staff, Amory Schauer, our financial administrator, is just at her wit's end, just because the Munis system is very, it's not very flexible. So I'm not sure that system would be the right system to use for this model. You know, Munis is old, it's an old system. And I just know what they use for a billing system.
Okay.
If you could ask them.
Yeah.
To me, this comes. I mean, this isn't going to come from us. This is going to come from.
Correct.
You know, backwards.
Well, I mean, the theory will come from here, and then it's up to the mayor really to approve it, and then push it forward, and ask the council to vote on it, and then we'd have to make sure we have the right software. Or the right billing
program. Right. He doesn't want the administrative union coming and picketing his office here. So.
No, usually when the mayor tells us to do something, there's no picketing.
You know, one thing I'm just aware of is that we have heard the mayor say on a number of occasions that if we present him with a plan for retraining Northampton in a significant way, he would be interested in exploring a way to fund it. So. In a way, that's our lowest hanging fruit. and to try to come up with this system of like nickel and diming the public of extra funds, it could be argued, well, you're doing this. Why do you need a big chunk of money, you know, from City Council? So I would like to table this because until we have a tree inventory, we really can identify. We have identified a thousand places where we want to plant trees. All we need now are the resources to do it. Then we make a compelling argument for, okay, this is our budget for planting these 1,000 trees in the ground.
Well, that is our compelling argument. We're going to place the ground we have for tree plantings and how many the funds to plant trees.
Yeah, and then we just outright ask the mayor, will you bond it or will you find a way to fund it?
Can bond it, can make their five-year capital plan, can do a lot of different things with it, so. But I do think that it would be good to try to explore that. But I think it's nice, in my opinion, to have the big. So we have the mayor's ear, obviously, right? We have a big chunk of change.
For at least, what, 3 more years?
3 more years.
Yeah,
we have a big chunk of change. So we basically have 3 years to take momentum we started this year and make it into a steamroller. So the next administration, wherever they may be, my political savvy at work time, you just kind of make it be. It's just. Your Honor, this is what we're doing, and this is all the public support that we have, Your Honor.
Right.
And there's not really much that, politically, if the mayor, whoever the present administration wants to be reelected, it's kind of a shell game. But I think what we started here is something good, and I think having this mayor willing to actually give us more money than is actually budgeted, because that's the message I'm getting.
Yeah.
Is good. It's really, it's great, actually.
So how does that sound to you as a strategy?
I think, given that the money is there now, even though we're not fully prepared to plant in the best possible way with the best stock, it does create an ongoing compelling argument to keep planting trees.
I think it presents an ongoing compelling argument to keep creating the best comprehensive tree program we can.
Yeah.
And that does not necessarily mean rushing trees in the ground. It means creating a program, you know, a comprehensive program.
Well, I realize the money could instead go to building a nursery, which would be good.
Or you know, identifying the specimen trees that have been neglected for ages and pruning and cabling them, or, you know, all sorts of things.
Right. Well, I bring it up because I'm trying to figure out what we'll be doing next year and just thinking ahead.
I think having the tree inventory is really going to, after we analyze all that data,
right,
I think we're really going to be amazed at it's going to really
give us some guidance.
Yeah, it's going to say this is the data, this is what you're going to need to do. These are 1,000 sites, these are 8,000 trees we inventoried, you know, blah, blah, blah. I think it's just going to be a lot of stuff we're going to have to digest, and then from there we can actually develop a plan as to how we're going to move forward. And then once we have the inventory, it's also a tool to go and ask for more money.
Right, that's the ammunition.
On both sides, for the maintenance aspect of things, for existing mature trees and the planting sites.
Right.
If we get the DCR grant, when would inventory possibly happen?
I think our timeline was basically late spring, early summer.
Yeah.
And having everything finalized, because the city has to pay for the whole inventory up front, and then DCR will reimburse the city for the $30,000. That's to be done within a year's time. So we have to have everything wrapped up basically by November 1st of 2016.
Have we contacted anyone yet to see?
Yeah, we've contacted two people to get rough estimates for the purpose of for the grant proposal. Yeah, and they both came recommended. Davies was one, and then the other one was called
Harbor
something.
I want to say Harbor Tech, but that's not right.
Something like that.
Ropes.
What is it?
I said those are the ropes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So just to make sure that we keep on moving along. So I also had an interview with Nick Horton, Friends of Northampton Trails and Greenway. And the bottom line is, I take us back to that original email from Alan Seawald, where he said, a Friends of Northampton Trees could be established as a 501c3 and controlled by individuals concerned with our urban treescape, but not, underlined, members of the Public Shade Tree Commission. And, you know, he said this is a model used, you know, widely and so forth. And then he reemphasized again, the issue arises when the commission members make direct or targeted solicitations of money. Direct solicitations raise the specter of coercion, particularly when directed to individuals or groups, even, example, downtown business owners who have dealings with the city, such as needing permits or licenses. So, in other words, my interview with Nick clearly demonstrated that we could create such a fund in it, and there would probably be a lot of interest in Northampton for funding it. They raise about $5,000 a year every year through a direct mailing, and Valley Gives, that they turn over a check straight to the planning office for design work for trails and greenways. We could do a very, when I say we, I mean Northampton citizens, excluding the people in this room, could do a very similar kind of thing where we raise money for trees and write a check to the city with a memo for exclusively for tree planting or something like that. You know, we could set up the parameters. It's a very easy thing to establish. It doesn't take a lot of administrative overhead. It gives people a way to give where they know they're going to get a tax deduction acknowledgement. I don't know if the city usually writes, you know, tax acknowledgements the way Friends groups do. But the bottom line is, none of us can do this. And we would have to find other people who are Friends of Northampton Trees to establish something like this.
What extents would we be in communication, or would there be connectivity with such a group? Just so that our efforts could be coordinated and not...
I think it's, you know, it's just a dangerous area because of issues of conflict of interest. I guess, so I can't really say there could be any official connectivity.
But we would want them to know what we're doing, and we would,
yeah, I think
to some extent, want to know what they're up to.
Yeah. I could get more clarity from Alan Seawald if such a group were to form with composed of people outside of this commission, what kind of relationship would the commission have with them, if any?
We would want it to be supportive, not
as individual members, as individual citizens, but not as representatives of the commission.
Yeah.
We really only need three, right?
Three what?
Members to set up a nonprofit.
No, I'm just talking about in terms of them having some relationship with the Public Shade Tree Commission. If a Friends group were to establish, would we, as a commission, have any relationship with this body?
Well, what about Friends of Forbes Library? I mean, they
nothing,
must have
nothing to stop them from coming in and talking to us.
Yeah,
and
right, right.
Coordination
right.
Sessions. I mean, all that's possible.
It is. Okay. I want to be clear on it before I.
Yeah, we don't want there to be conflict of interest, but at the same time, for the sake of the purpose of both the commission and a Friends group. I would imagine somehow we would want there to be some coordination, even if it's not official. Just, well, we know what you're doing, you know what we're doing, and we're supporting you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Do you have people in mind?
I don't. I mean, yeah, that's kind of a problem, is that if it is excluding everybody in this room, it's going to be harder to fund those people.
Well, the volunteer list.
Like quite everyone in this room.
There were people who were wanted to volunteer who couldn't dig holes, which I assume they mean to do other kind of work. Well, it's been really hard to find people who are going to do paperwork, emailing, that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
A little bit hard.
But once again, I go back to, I feel like our most important strategy right now is getting to the point where we can present a plan to the mayor.
Mm-hmm.
And that is more of an ongoing, how do we fund a program going forward?
Going forward, I'm kind of diverting again. I just want to touch back on why I was asking about whether we're going to continue planting trees, and that is that part of the reason we had trouble getting trees this year was that we got in late, and that other people are now, right now,
putting
their orders in.
Mm-hmm.
So we're headed into the same, if we knew we weren't planting and or we were planting next fall, that would be good, but now is the time to start talking to the nurseries. You can do it without making a total commitment, but somehow or other, if you don't...
You're talking about additional trees, not the ones we've already got reserved.
Correct.
If you want like another 60 trees, so it'd be 100 trees total next year, same as this year. I'm not saying you do, but if you did, and you don't decide to do that, then the other municipalities and whatnot have taken up the stock that we're interested in.
I personally don't feel, I don't feel compelled by that urgency because we're at a different stage, and we're at the stage now where it's really important that we kind of get some foundational pieces in place, and the inventory is the foundation for where we're going to be planting future trees. So if it means that we're only planting 40 trees this spring,
well, and maybe not plant in the fall.
I think what Rob's alluding to is the fact that nurseries, because the nursery stock is, and Jay can attest to this, is really difficult to obtain the nursery stock, that if we want to plant trees next fall, we need to think about actually putting order together this winter. So, and if
you don't actually
put an order together and actually get an order in to a nursery, get the trees selected, or it's multiple nurseries because we're not, and then have those ready to be given to us in the fall of next year.
It also comes down to budget plan. How much are the 30 grants left?
There's like 37,000 left right now.
For FY15 or 16?
Yeah, for FY16.
Yeah. Right. And how much of that are we setting aside for the inventory? Are we starting that before July 1st?
The inventory, the funds for the inventory, my guess would be 30. The monies would be encumbered. So for example, there'd be an active contract, so that $37,000, say I don't spend any more of it, the monies will be encumbered, there'll be $65,000 encumbered somewhere to pay for that contract at the end of the contract, which will probably end next fiscal year, not the one we're in, but the following one. So the monies that we have presently would be eaten up to pay for the inventory unless...
We don't get the match.
Unless we don't get the match, or the other positive thing would be is if we went to the mayor and said, you know, we want to buy another 100 trees next fall, this is our dilemma, but we also want to do the inventory, you know, would you be willing to set aside X amount of dollars from free cash to either do the two of them, or the other directive is the mayor could say, well, last year you returned X amount of dollars, so I anticipate you'll have enough, so just spend out of your existing budget. So it's just kind of a shell game. I think that we would be, it would be good for us to, if we're going to think about planting in the fall, that we should start to think about it, you know, come December. Yeah. And then figure out how much money we're going to expend and have that set aside, and then we just got to wait for the DCR approval to come through or disapproval, I guess you should say.
Okay, I want to move us into a to-do list recap. And that will be, I mean, I'll put this topic on the next agenda. Also, in that interim, Jay is going to be exploring a little bit more the Bear Roof. We know that the Bear Roof option is going to have a much wider variety of trees come January. So that's what he said, is that the 2016 list is coming out in January.
So just a subtlety to it is we actually went to some of these people and said, this is what we want next year. We might actually get it, that's all.
Okay.
They might actually dig up, find, produce what we...
Okay. All right.
All right, this is in the order that I heard it, so here we go. Rich set up a revolving account for the tree commission. Rich and Rob meet tomorrow to discuss remaining tree planting. Rich complete the Tree City USA paperwork to maintain our status. Rich talk with building commissioner and also work on the trench permit edits. Todd create structure around tree protection policy.
Or done.
All right, check. And Jay, Rich, and Jen send to Todd their tree protection policies, if you need it. Jay help Lily, oh, Jay, Myra, and Todd help Lily start research chart and process for nursery. Lily and Marilyn meet to discuss a survey and getting it into a CSV file. Marilyn, I'm going to particularly focus on this week with the volunteer answers to the survey and communicate that to Rob. Jen and Rob work on the spring planting plan. Lily, you were going to do something with the door hangers?
Yes.
Rich to begin a tree pruning process with Rich and Jay, right? And Lily follow up about the friends group. Did I miss anything?
Okay.
Good.
Great, and you'll dump those into the to-do list?
Yep.
Okay. Is there any other business?
Just, I did move your tree, in case you had...
Thank you, I did notice. Yes, that was yesterday, the day before. So you swapped it out with the one in front of...
Right.
Great.
One in front.
So if you can think of another place to put that other columnar tree, if you can swap another one.
The one in front of Lathrop Home, or...
No, it's not that far down. That's a more of a pyramidal tree. I think it's a little bit further up because I planted it. It's maybe another block up. But it's the same exact with Podamba.
Okay.
But what is it?
Sweet gum.
Sweet gum, the upright sweet gum.
Yeah, it's that silhouette one, you know, the variety that doesn't get watered in 4 feet. And then if you all have a tree, if you're looking for a site for a tree that is a very, very, you know, effective shade tree, you know, like a broad one, then when Jay takes that one out, that site that he's leaving blank could accept a...
Oh, a place to put it.
Yeah.
You know, if I can address or something.
I can get you the address. I'll get you both the address.
Okay.
I'm going to pass it to you.
Because I won't get it, once the tree's gone, it'll be hard to...
Right, okay, I'll get you an address. Can you put that?
Maybe.
South Street, Liquid Amber Tree. Okay, great. Any other business? Motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, this meeting is adjourned.
Aye.